All right, be safe, be smart, have fun. It's Sunday, and I'm going on a Hayabusa ride, and just a pleasure ride, not commuting or anything. And I guess I'm just finally realizing that this bike is very expensive to insure, and it's the most expensive bike to insure. I know that now and realize it now, but I love it. I love riding it. But the premiums are really, really high. And having a really good insurance policy with the Gixxer 600 that I have together annually, it's about $5,000 for insurance. So quarterly, I'm putting out like, what, you know, a lot of money, like $1,200, $1,250 every 3 months. That's a lot. So there are other motorcycles, kind of big, sporty, touring-ish motorcycles like the Honda VFR 1200F. Maybe not the best loved or reviewed bike, but it's sporty, and it gets a lot less insurance. It costs less to own. So this bike costs more to own, but it's such a pleasure and a joy to ride. Now, someone like me who rides like a grandpa anyway, I'm not getting half the performance out of it that it has. But I enjoy it when I do pop the throttle. And I do love the torque down low at lower gears. I love how it pulls. And I like the stability and high speeds on the freeway. And I like the fact that this bike isn't super, super high tech either. There's not a whole lot of settings to play with. And that's good. I mean, it's almost old-fashioned. It's getting near the end of its lifespan, probably. But that's okay. Still, I got this bike sort of on clearance. 2013 model in 2014. So if I sold both bikes, if I sold the Gixxer, which I don't ride as much, my first sport bike, which has sentimental value to me, I would definitely, a little scratch here, huh, first time I'm seeing that scratch, actually, kind of a dirt scratch. I'm not sure what that's from. Could be from a boot. Not bad, though. Interesting. But, now that I see it, that's all I can see. If I sold the Gixxer, my insurance premiums would go down. It'd be more affordable. It would go down like $1,500 a year, which is nice. If I sold both bikes and just got like the Honda VFR, rode more like a grandpa, pipe and slippers, cause that's how I drive, it'd be a lot cheaper and I might, you know, work for me, but at least while I have this, I like it. And maybe it's just bike-itis, thinking I have to get another bike, but maybe if I live with this, the cost will go down over time. I've already modded the levers. I haven't even owned it for a year yet. And let's just keep it going, I guess, and just make it work for me financially. So if that means selling the Gixxer, so be it. Because I like this bike a lot. I like the look. I like how customizable it is. Anyway, that's my story. So I'll probably talk about those issues on this ride some. And if I get around to it, maybe I can edit this into a YouTube video. So, I've also got my winter coat on, which is a bit overkill. But I'd much rather be warm today than cold. And it's a little cold-ish at night. It's 1 o'clock now, right? 1:20. Warming up a bit, but still has that very late November sunlight. Sun will go down soon. It'll keep going down sooner until, what, December 20th or the 21st, whenever the solstice is. So, alright. I'm going to take her up on Skyline. Get on the 24, try to go over to Livermore. See how I do. Got a full tank-ish of gas. I'm sure the tires are fine. Tire pressure. That's it for the miles here. I only have 2,100 miles since April. Obviously, I don't ride a whole lot. So, that's my story again. All right, here we go. Nice. I don't feel any wind except for on my face with the open helmet. And I love how this bike pulls. It's just like really nice in the low gears. Ridiculous torque and engine size, but it works very well together. I feel productive on this bike, if you will. I feel like I really can ride it well. Now, I don't have my additional lining in the pants or the coat. I can feel a little bit of breeze on my pants, but I think I'll get used to it. Maybe overkill. I mean, these could be like winter linings that I don't have on right now that I'm talking about, and I probably don't need, because it's not like there's snow out or it's freezing temperatures. It's just like cold, and it's a little nippy for California. At least we're somewhere in the low 50s today. But see, like, I like how you sit low in this bike, and I feel confident turning and using the throttle to help me get through curves. I can't do that with a Gixxer. Even though the Gixxer is more of a sporty bike and a track bike, it's just less compliant for the way I ride, or at least the way I like riding. Like here, you just use the engine to help you out all the time. Like right here, I feel like I can lean, push into it, throttle out of the curb, and I just love that. Now, Gixxer's got some of it, but it's less likely to turn in. Like, the wheel doesn't point as easily. I've talked about this before. Maybe it's a steering damper. I've reset the Gixxer to its factory suspension settings from the Showa adjustable forks, you know, dampening and rebound, as well as preload. I've got the tire pressure correct. That helped, all that helped a bit. I think that bike's got about 4,000 miles on it now. I haven't replaced the tires yet. They're still OEM tires. You know, the good old Bridgestone Battle Axe. I think it's Bridgestone, right? The Battle Axe. And they're fine. Why throw money at it if I don't know what the problem is, really? So, by getting new tires. Everybody says, oh, get new tires. Well, but they're not worn yet. They're not super worn yet. I think basically with owning a motorcycle and thinking about the next bike or what are you going to get, you can get lost with the idea like, well, you really need to ride a motorcycle. It's not just about the purchasing and coveting what you don't have. It's actually using what you have and being satisfied with what you have. It's sort of like being present when you talk with somebody or have a conversation. Be present with them. Don't always think about what you could have had or what is bad, or being critical of yourself or your things just because being critical sounds like you're being smart or evaluating stuff. I mean, have genuine satisfaction and get the most out of what you have with what you've got. Now, me saying all that sounds like a great philosophy, but I am probably like any good American consumer, thinking like I need something else. But this bike for me is an exception in the sense like I am thinking about lowering the insurance cost, but that's the only thing I don't like about this bike is the insurance cost. I like everything else about it. It's easy for me to ride. I like the riding position quite a bit, even though, you know, you're all hunched over in the sport bike. I kind of like it. And the performance is outstanding. I'm definitely used to the controls. The brakes are fine for me. I find them sensitive. And now that the bike has broken in pretty well with 2,100 miles, I mean, the throttle response is wonderful. There's no, it's very linear, if that's the word. I don't feel any spittering. I don't feel any delayed reaction on the throttle. The engine braking is really nice with this big engine. I think that's part of the fact that it has a slipper clutch. It's just really, really compliant. So I think sticking with the philosophy of like, be satisfied with what you have, be present with what you have, get the most out of what you have, makes sense for this, because I like this bike. Getting rid of it, I think I'd regret it, just for some stupid fucking financial reason. I mean, truth be told, I can afford the high insurance. I just don't want to, because I think it's a scam. That being said, this is like the most powerful sport bike. However, it's super heavy. So maybe not the fastest now, or the necessarily the easiest one to kill yourself with. But it definitely has a reputation because it's so fucking fast, and people will go fast and hurt themselves really bad. So the insurance cost to cover all of that catastrophic kind of injury is important. And I get it, but the marketplace has changed a bit with there being lighter 1,000 liter sport bikes with huge ass engines, like the Kawasaki H2 just came out. 300 horsepower, or better yet, 200 horsepower for the street version. And it's under 500 pounds, right? It's under 500 pounds. That thing is just terrible if it didn't have all these electronic aids to help you out. Like, this bike does not have electronic aids, really. Just ABS. I don't think there's electronic traction or stability controls or anything like that. But to the original point, there are now lighter bikes that are super powerful that should also have really high insurance premiums. I feel like the fact that this bike is heavy, it does go fast, but the fact that it is heavy, you're more inclined to like stay on the road, not fall off it or something. Not fall off. Like, I guess the fact that it is heavy keeps you planted better. Or maybe it's just the configuration of this bike. Then another. I mean, to be fair, I've never, like, ridden a liter bike at all. This is more than a liter, right? This is 1373, but I've never driven a liter sport bike. That's the lighter weight, full-ass fucking 1,000 cc's. You know, one step away from the World Superbike Championships. Kind of bike. And again, to this bike's credit, just going here like 30, 35 miles an hour, because that's the closest speed limit here, I haven't gotten out of second gear. I haven't needed to. I just like that. Beautiful, nice day. I mean, not a lot of traffic. Nice and crisp, you won't get too hot. Not that I've ever had I've never really overheated on a bike. I've never really gotten super cold either, but I can see a creature comfort on a bike maybe being like heaters, grip heaters, but just, you know, wear thicker gloves or what have you. Plus, right now I have an underlayer on, just a shirt I got at, you know, TJ Maxx that was thick, athletic, kind of one of those poly things that looks like you can sweat through it.
has like a mock turtleneck that keeps me pretty warm. And with this jacket, where you can, you have like a definite like turtleneck style collar, or a good collar that goes up quickly, there's wind won't get in as bad. So my point is, I feel protected. I'm gonna go down here to the freeway. Just keep it calm. Don't try to prove anything that would kill myself proving nothing. I'm all about vehicles, I guess. I really like motorsports. I really like cars. I love the mechanics of it. I love thinking about cars. I love driving cars. I love driving motorcycles, thinking about motorcycles, everything. So this past week was actually quite a motor week for me, because I got another used car. I have to sell my other car, but it's a nice one. Best car I've ever had. Tracy really loves it, and we're going to have fun with it driving down to L.A. to visit my folks. It was expensive, so that's why I'm sort of freaking out about insurance now. But also, I finally got a hold of my insurance agent after I got the Busa. It's only been months, because she wasn't very responsive, and she's confirmed indeed. And then I looked it up finally on my own that, yeah, the Hayabusa is the most expensive bike to insure. Catastrophically higher, seems like. Not catastrophic, but like geometrically more. Geometric progressionally more. Alright, getting in on the freeway here. Be safe, be smart, have fun. I love you, Tracy. And don't want to break any speed limits. Or speed records, I should say. Haha. And here we go. Right? No drama. I love this bike. It's so nice. And there. If I close the mouth intake, I get less air, but it's helps me defrost the windshield. So I'll keep it open. But I have to find other ways to make this helmet a bit quieter. So maybe it's a showy helmet, RF 1100. Perhaps I can use the clicky thing over here. Does that help? Nope. Alright, back where it was. Anyway, let's concentrate on the road, shall we? Fifth gear, in the slow lane, going like 70, 75. Bike feels fine, I feel fine, I'm totally comfortable. One possibility is like if I keep this bike for sport touring only, I'm not going to be racing. Maybe the bigger windshield would be a little nicer on a long trip. And maybe it's something I could interchange. If I go on long trips, I just put it in. If I'm just commuting, having this bike on the weekends, I use this OEM shield. Touring shields I'm thinking of are, there's a company, I forgot what it's called, Zero Gravity or something like that. It's a company that sells Hayabusa windshields. They also make OEM windshields for everyone else. I'd keep it the same color, just a little higher up. It is all it would do. And kind of give me more resistance into the wind. So, another reason why I'm taking this route today is it's been rainy in California the past week, pretty good, and we've really needed it. So, as you've seen some of my other videos, when I was riding in April, I was just so delighted to be where it was really green in the meadow, and now there's a chance of some greenery because we just had rain. Still, it's not winter yet, it's fall. Things are dying, you know, autumnally, or seasonally, if you will. But we did get some water, and there should be like a little bit of a fuzz of grass, I think. You can kind of see it in front of me. Let's pick up the speed a little bit. I'm going slower than everyone else, because that's just the way I ride. I'm not going that fast. That was fast. Somebody passing me. So, some of you young guns out there get really pissed that I let a fucking Prius pass me. Yeah, well, why do I need to, like, break the law? I mean, is it an ego thing that I got this bike in order to be the fastest? I did not get this bike to be the fastest. I got this bike because it looks like nothing else. And it's a classic, I think. And it's big. I like it because it's big. And it's good for long distance. And it generally is reviewed pretty well. And that's why I got it. And I confirm that I like it a lot. It's not to be the badass, it's not to have a reputation. I don't think I've yet had a vehicle, and I've gotten it because of what I want people to think of me. Or, you know, being badass. I mean, I even got a Harley Davidson Sportster, and boy, that is somewhat of a poser bike in the sense of you're buying into the Harley Davidson look. And I thought it would be a great motorcycle, but it's just heavy, uncompliant suspension, and it just hurt riding it. It just felt like metal hitting metal whenever you go over a bump. And plus, I was really a sport bike guy anyway. I like getting a cruiser was just the wrong idea. But if you think in your head, what does a motorcycle look like? You think, you know, the Harley Davidson Sportster is the closest you can get to a standard, what, you know, classic standard. It's been the same from the 1950s probably, even though it probably has roots earlier than that. Maybe even the 40s. But as far as poser bikes go, you could say since it was a Harley, you're trying to look like a Harley rider and trying to be a Harley guy. You know, you drink whiskey and you listen to the blues or something like that. And that is not me. I'm not that kind of guy. I'm a software engineer into high tech. But I'm also sort of a classical music guy. I have a music degree, and sport bikes are more about classic engineering to me. Some very hard problems. High performance, low weight, present a lot of, and aerodynamics present a lot of issues that I appreciate being solved by engineering. And yeah, I already have mentioned that I am a car guy. I just like I like driving. I like the performance of driving a fine car, a fine vehicle. So, the Harley Davidson is just not that, but if you're into that whole look of what Harley's selling, the Sportster is a fine bike, and it's the fit and finish on the Harley is great. Like, there isn't any kind of plasticky, chintzy parts at all. The wiring harnesses and all that other kind of stuff are well hidden. You don't really feel like it's got as much technology even as it does, right? Like, it's fuel injected. It's got auto canceling turn signals and a lot of other little things like that, which you wouldn't think a Harley would, but it does. Like, it's not trying to be a 1950 bike. It's a modern bike that has a classic look. Now, since then, in general, Cycle technology has improved manyfold by suspension, by engine and performance and weight. And I'd like to take advantage of some of that. I find it safer, more enjoyable, and that's where I am. Now, it's November 2014, and I was thinking like sometime in this late summer, early fall, or at some point, I would take an extended motorcycle trip, and I got luggage for this, like soft luggage for this bike. I haven't done that yet, and frankly, I just took like a 2-week trip to Europe, where I obviously didn't motorcycle ride in October, and that kind of took my time off of work. And I think in general too, when I get more riding under my belt and become a better rider, I'll probably think of these longer trips and probably will be able to actually accomplish them with a little bit more gusto. I should say, be more willing to go on these trips. I certainly would not like to maintain this speed or go on a very long trip with the Gixxer. Now, the Gixxer is very smooth at these speeds, I agree, but I can't turn in as well with it. And at one point I had to merge onto a freeway in a high-speed right-hand turn, and I overcooked the turn and it scared me. I'm like, why didn't it turn in? And what are the BMWs I like? Well, the new S1000RR 2015 model, geez, boy, did they hit it out of the ballpark on paper with that one, BMW. What a beautiful bike. Now, sitting on it ergonomically, it feels great, and from what people say about the older S1000RR, is it has so many electronic aids, it really helps you out. No, even if you're like a relative newbie to motorcycles like me, or even veterans, it should really be nice. I mean, for me, I don't want to give up the Hayabusa, but I feel like if I got something like the S1000RR, I mean, that's the only thing I'd ride. But it goes back to my original thing of what would you like to do for a long distance tour? It's this, and that's kind of the kind of bike I like, I think. I like heavier bikes. At least I have a heavy and a not heavy bike, and I like riding the heavier one. And I'm not Mr. Twisty. I'm not all about putting my knee down. I mean, hell, I'd like to, because you're supposed to be a motorcyclist, and if you're a real motorcyclist, you can put your fucking knee down. I mean, I haven't gotten there yet. I'd like to have maybe the California Superbike School, if I could afford it, or have someone give me those lessons. Boy, that would be fantastic, where you have a controlled setting. You can try leaning over, because they have like those bikes with the training wheels that help you lean over a bit, and then try a track, and if anything, just to get my confidence up, that would be really nice. See, I can go 80 miles an hour. I've got guts. This bike can do it. It can do it all. Black Hawk Auto Museum. Nice museum. It's where the first time I saw a BMW 507 from the 50s. Such a beautiful, beautiful car. Do I like this bike? And like, hell yeah, I fucking love this bike. I don't know if I want a VFR. A Honda 1200 VFR, which nobody seems to love very much. It's high tech. It's a V4, which is interesting. It's heavier than this bike, though. But this bike just performs so well. I love it. There's just power for days. It's like my new car. My new car is a V8 twin turbo 400 horsepower monster. Granted, it's an SUV, so it's heavy, but you wouldn't know that it's heavy by the way that the engine response and the throttle response is fantastic. So this is like one of the biggest four-cylinder engines you can get for a motorcycle, right? And it's got the same thing. Like, it just goes for days. It's all naturally aspirated though, but my point is big engine, bigger smile, bigger performance, period. I love it. If you have a chance to buy a bigger engine car and it's just a few more $1,000s, I say do it, because I'm not opposed to electric. I'm just saying a bigger, more responsive engine, always get the bigger responsive engine. If you're into motorsports, naturally aspirated, gasoline, turbo, electric, hell, steam power, get the bigger engine because it's more fun. It just is. Now, the argument about horsepower versus torque, sure, I guess I can understand torque a lot and horsepower, but I mean, I guess it's the end result that matters. Does a bike or does a car pull? Does it respond to the throttle? Does, and the other thing too with these like fancy automatic cars, when you push the gas and you need to get out in front of somebody because you know like if you don't move it quick, you're gonna get in trouble. Does the car lurch and respond quickly? Or does it think about it and fumble? So the previous car that I had with a 6-speed automatic, not bad, it had to always be in sport mode or else it didn't respond quickly enough when you like engage. It hunted for the right gear, like it would always downshift, or first it'd say, do I think I have to downshift? I think I'm gonna downshift, I'll downshift. And then by that time, you're out, you're still, you know, the danger zone is increased. Like, if you were trying to get out in front of somebody, forget it. But once it did engage, it was like really good. But just like, why did it take so long to engage? Moral of the story, make a car that performs, or a motorcycle that performs when you want it to. Don't have an excuse as to why there isn't instant power. Nice road. Alright, no one behind me. And it's twisty area. Yay. Enjoying motorcycle. I mean, I'm okay with twisties. But I just don't like having to follow people or have people behind me because... Or if I'm riding in a group. I mean, I like Russ and Tracy and riding with them a lot. Like, I like where we go. I like the distance of where we go. But there's a lot of starting and stopping, but also... I just don't like comparing myself to anyone else at the same time, so I feel like I'm not doing something right. Like, Tracy and Russ really like the curves and getting into the curves, but it stresses me out. That being said, I'm better on my own at attempting curves. Pretty, pretty. Now, the thing with the country road is it's not really meant for super high speed, so I could go 60, 65, but that's not cool. A lot more bumps. Could be unexpected rural traffic. Like somebody pulling out somewhere. And with a suggested curve. Is that an F-type? Yeah. An F-Type. Jaguar F-Type. Alright, here we are, Collier Canyon. Those cruisers, baggers up there aren't going that way. It's good for me. Alright, this is one of my favorite roads. It's not because it's like super twisty or anything, but it's just like a quiet road. Clears my mind. Wait a minute. See that? I kind of braked too late, took the speed, took the curve a little too hot, but I should have turned into the curve as well. But those are the kinds of things that, as a motorcyclist, I have to get better at. I wish I had an outside temperature gauge somewhere. That'd be kind of informative. That way you can know if how cold it is. Or maybe if you lived in a really, really cold region, you could see what was freezing. But having ridden, I've never seen the bike. It's at a pretty low temperature range. It's always below half, but it's really, really below half of cold to high. Because it's nice and cool outside. And I'm not stuck in traffic. That's another thing about this bike I kind of wish I had, was a digital speedometer. This old school analog stuff is kind of neat because you feel like you're in a fighter jet or an old fashioned airplane. Which is nice for a Hayabusa being a falcon, peregrine falcon, you know, like a plane, but it's harder to read the gauges. I mean, it's not telling you how fast it is, you have to read it. But I like the design. A traditional speedometer that just tells you the speed, it's almost like inefficient to have a big dial. It takes up more space. But there's also something dramatic about like seeing it go from low to high, the needle moving. All right, be safe, be smart, have fun. Love you, Tracy. Getting on the freeway. The road's much better than before. So maybe they are improving it. Nice road conditions. Pushing the bike near 5,000 RPM, which it can totally handle, but I've had a break-in alert light about it. They wanted to keep it at 45 or 5,000 RPM while you're braking it in. I just always kept the alert in. So this is, okay, 80, not 90, I'm going 80, alright. So pretty fucking fast. I'm glad I've got this emergency lane here in the left. This road is so smooth though. Gives you a lot of confidence. Tuck a little better for lay on the tank and tuck. For aerodynamics. I don't necessarily need it though. I don't feel very buffeted. Alright, slowing down a bit. Shit road. Come on, people, figure out your freeway surfaces. Let's all be like Germany and get the Autobahn working. Bumpy! That one time I was really afraid to take this highway. But they're not going super fast, but I wouldn't have done it in a Harley Davidson, that's for sure. Or with a bike without fairings, I wouldn't like it as much. But, like anything, con brio with confidence. If you have confidence, you can do it. And my confidence is justified because I have more experience. Or at least that's where it comes from. Doing is knowing. A little bit of a sixth gear fade. The engine wants to rev a little bit more if you're like coasting. We're not using a whole lot of throttle at 70, I've noticed before. And it gets in a very unresponsive state. It's basically sort of saying like you don't need the overdrive. You actually need a little bit more gear. But it doesn't last for very long. Wow, I've used a lot of gas. But I'm really enjoying this ride. I mean, it's not twisties, and it doesn't have to be, but it's just so much fun. I think, like, I won't get gas until the bike tells me to get gas. I think there's a light that goes on. Feel that fade? That, like, overdrive fade? Nice.